I have a message today that's kind of, I told you last week, I told everybody, I had a Christmas message with a twist. And this twist is a good twist. I don't know, you know, we've got some good things out there, some bad things. I've seen some good messages. I've seen some really good messages. I've seen people that gave the Christmas story, but I wanted it to have some meaning and show us that we're living in the last days also. So the twist is, Jesus is coming back. So I will start in a manger and a baby being born, and I will end up with him being on the throne and being the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen? Amen. In the Matthew, the first chapter, the 21st verse, it says this. And I've got it up on the screen up here. You can read off of there, or you can get in your Bible. And he shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is, God is with us. And knew her not until she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. God, I come to you this morning, God, just thanking you for your son, Jesus Christ. God, I thank you for the plan from the very foundation of the earth. God, that you had a plan to bring him and let him be born of the Virgin Mary. God, that he'd be incarnate with you and he would come to save his people. God, he would come to bring us hope of a future in heaven with you. God, that he came that men might be saved. God, he came that men might be healed. God, he came that we could have a relationship with you, O God, which we could not have before. God, I am thanking you for all these things, and I know, God, that you are hearing my prayer right now. And God, I want you to apply everything to our church and our lives and these here. God, that we need in our life, that we may become closer to you. And Lord Jesus, you said to come close as a mention of your name. And God, I want to be that close that when I mention your name, that I feel heaven open. God, that I feel your spirit moving in my life and that I don't have to pray hard. I don't have to go into lengthy prayers and I don't have to read the Bible just to get your spirit into my spirit. And God, I feel that every day and I thank you for all that I feel from you and know that you are alive and you're still at the right hand of God and you are still making intercession for your people. God, you're still doing the things you did 2,000 years ago, that all that you did then, you're still doing now. Give us faith, God, and increase our faith to know that you're able to do all these things. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. You know that Jesus, when he came and he was born in a manger, the people were not expecting him to come in that manner. The Jews were looking for him to come as a king within royalty. They were looking for him to have a crown upon his head. And I see that the prince and princess were here the other day, and they're royalty. And they come from England, they come over here, and everybody puts up a big to-do about them, and all the cameras, and all the paparazzi, all the people are out there because they're royalty. And they don't have to tell anybody, they don't have to go around announcing, I'm a prince, and she didn't have to say, I'm a princess, and they don't have to go around saying that because everybody knows when they see their picture or see them, they know that they are royalty, that they live in a palace. I mean, they have wealth beyond measure, and they have clout with all the people. Amen? So this didn't happen to baby Jesus. He came and Joseph and Mary, as they left and they had to leave because Herod was threatening to kill all the children, was looking for them and asked the wise men, where are they at? Where is this King Jesus? See, he wanted to put them all to death, all the male child children. He wanted to kill them. And here Jesus is born in a manger because there was no room in the inn. And he came and they asked for a room and there was no room. And it had to come just like God said it would come, like it was prophesied in Isaiah in the 16th chapter. He prophesied and told about the baby child coming. It had to come in such a way that God would make it to where the people that really knew, that he was coming in such a manner, that's the way he was coming. He would not be found in a palace. He would not be a king sitting on a throne. He would not have a crown upon his head. He would not be clothed in royal purple clothes, and he wouldn't have all the wealth of the world. Jesus Christ came to save that which was lost. He came to serve. He wanted to serve. He was not the master. He said, I come to serve. He came in a manner that people did not want to accept him. They didn't want to say, that's a king. Why would a king be born in a stable? Why would he be born, amongst all the animals? And why would he be born? born that way, that can't be. How can a carpenter's son, how could a mere woman be the son of Jesus Christ, of God? How could this be? See, my God works in mysterious ways. He does not work in our ways. He does things in His way. He does it in His time. We see it was 740 years from the prophecy of Isaiah prophesying in the 16th chapter about the child being born until Jesus came in the New Testament and He was born. God does things in His time. We always want to get in a hurry and make God do it right now, don't we? We're always trying to tell God when to do it and how to do it. God, I want it, God, do it in the next 5 minutes, and I want you to do it just like this. Here's my instructions, how you want me to do it. God standing up in the brink of heaven, He goes, who are you to tell me what to do, how to do it, when to do it, and why to do it? God saying, I will do it in my way, in my time, and if I decide not to do it, you're not getting it. Amen? How many has to ever scold your child or take something away? Did it hurt you? Did it make you feel bad? Because you had to do it, but you had to do it, didn't you? I mean, it hurts when you have to correct your child, when you got to do things you don't want to do, but you have to, because I read in my Bible, it tells me that if we spare the rod, we spoil the child. You can't just slap your kid on the leg. Nowadays, you're going to get kicked out of NFL. You're going to get in all kinds of trouble just for whipping your child or correcting your child. I know you got to do it carefully, and you got to do it, you know, the right way, but when you correct your child in the right way, that it will not hurt them. Amen. You can whip their backside. They're going to cry for a little bit, and then you'll go away and cry because you made them cry. And you know, you'll feel bad about it, but you'll get over it, and they'll get over it. Amen. Matter of fact, when you grow up, you're going to look back and see that you did get those whippings when you needed it, and you're going to thank your mom and dad for doing it because it kept you straight and it gave you the right attitude and did all the right things to make you the right person, and you turned out okay. Now, you see the ones that's running around today, they have no correction, they have no punishments, they have nothing at home to tell them right from wrong. Guess where they're going to end up? We have places called prison. We have places where they get incarcerated because they cannot deal with the outside of the prison and the society, and they are nothing but destruction coming our way. We got to know that Jesus Christ came to make this world a better place. But see, the Pharisees saw Him as coming to destroy their laws, and they could not get over the fact that Jesus Christ came, and they said, you're breaking our laws. He didn't live by their laws. For the first thing, He came to be a king and a ruler over the people, but He also came to be their Savior. And He didn't come to fulfill their law, He came to fulfill the law. Their law was the laws that they had made for themselves that they were not even able to live by, because they had taken and created so many laws, and they had put all these laws in effect that they couldn't even live by them themselves. So therefore, they were you know, outside of their laws, and the people couldn't live by the law because it was so hard and so harsh. And Jesus came, and He said, I did not come to destroy your laws. I did not come to tear down your laws, but He said, I come that they may should be made easier and better. Amen? So that's what Jesus, He came to do. In Matthew 2:1-4, it says, Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. We know the story of where they saw the star. And they followed the star, and they came, and it directed them. And see, that star was kind of like a GPS we have today, because they didn't have to know where to go. They just, as they traveled, as they come, the star would just keep moving across the sky. And it came to guide them and show them where the baby Jesus was, to give them direction. I don't know about you, but the star of David, He's the one that directs me. The star of David comes to give me direction, and He comes to set my feet on the right path, and He comes to open up the way for me that I may be able to see where I'm going and to know how to get where I'm going, because God has set His star in place for me. He has come and He set the star of David on the right hand of God, that I may be able to have a relationship with Him, that I can have a relationship with Jesus Christ that tells me that He is my Savior. He is my Lord. He is my healer. He is my everything. In Him I live and move and breathe and have my being. Because of Him, I'm alive. I'm not sure, but there's many times that, you know, I probably wouldn't be alive right now. Ron, look back at your youth and what you did and what we did and the way we caused ourselves, and we could have been killed many times. We put ourselves in danger, but see, God knows the end of our days, and He knows when we're going to make it right with Him. He knows what to do in the meantime when He's keeping us safe, Mr. Sherry. He's protecting us. How many knows that? He's the Star of David. He's the one that comes to give you strength when you're weak.
Yes.
He comes to heal you when you're sick, when you're infirmity in your body, when it comes. You know what? We don't know how it got there or why, but God knows how, and He knows why, and He knows how to deliver us from it.
Yes, amen.
He knows how to bring us to our body to health again when we're sick.
Amen.
He knows how to supply the funds when we don't have any. We don't know which way we're going to turn or what's going to happen next when the bill collectors are calling and we're getting notices in the mail, shut-off notices. We don't know what to do, but see, God does.
Amen.
God knows how to come, and He's an on-time God. He's always on time.
Yes, amen.
He might scare you to death sometimes, and He might make you wonder, what are we going to do? What's going to happen? Oh, God, what are we going to do now? God says, just hold on.
Right.
And He's an on-time God because He will always come and He'll make a way for you. Somehow He makes a way. And if He doesn't, you know, we need to go back and look, what did I do wrong, God? I know You didn't do anything wrong. You've never done anything wrong, but I've done something.
Right.
And I have to learn how to correct those things and get myself in the path of God and see what He does. And then I follow the star and I know where it's going and I know how to get to the place where God wants me.
Yes, amen.
See, that star will lead you and guide you and direct you. It will keep your path straight. It'll make the crooked way straight. It'll straighten you and it'll keep you where you need to be with God.
Yes, amen.
I need the star.
Yes, amen.
But the wise men, they followed the star. It directed them to where Jesus was in the manger.
Amen.
And they come bearing gifts. And they came to honor the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the mighty I Am. Not only did they just come to do that, but they come to fulfill prophecy. Because we see that prophecy was just fulfilled the other day when the Pope and President Obama come together. It was from the Bible scripture that says that in the last days this would happen and the two heads would come together. Now, this is what God's doing. God's putting this all together. We got to look at it as a good thing. It's not a good thing as we see it for our world, but it's a good thing because God says, come on, I'm shaking you, I'm waking you, and I'm showing you my prophecy of my word, and it tells in my Old Testament, and then it goes and takes it into further into the New Testament, and I'm showing you what I'm doing to bring this thing to an end, and I'm sending my son to come to rapture you. So I see it as a good thing. And they're coming together, and you know, everything's always about peace. Everything's about peace and restoring peace to the world. And we'll never see that peace. It will not come because of Matthew 24. It says there'll be wars and rumors of wars. Nation will rise against nation. So let me tell you something. When they say peace, it says peace, peace. It says sudden destruction will come upon them. Come on, read your word. Get in your Bible. You'll see where it says that. And we'll see that we're in the very last days and Jesus Christ is getting ready to split the eastern sky. He's coming to rapture His people. There will be no time for you to call upon His name. The Star of David will not be there no more. You won't have anything guiding you, leading you, directing to the sun because He's going to be gone. His spirit will be withdrawn. Matthew 1 and 2. Saying, where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled. And all Jerusalem with him. Oh boy, here we got the king. Word that there's another king coming. Everybody's always worried somebody's going to take their spot. Amen? You got to know that there's always somebody to replace you, no matter who you think you are or what position you have or where you're at. I always told my boys, I said, you know what, in your workplace, remember, you go in and you do the best job you can do every single day and you put forth all the effort you've got to make sure that you've earned your money for that day and you go back and you do it again and again and again. If you want to rise in that company, then you show initiative. You have to go in and show them that you want to be there. You're not just there for a paycheck. There's people I know that when they go to get their paycheck, they go like this. They can't even look their employer in the eye because they haven't done nothing that week to earn their paycheck, but yet they're just there for a check. They're not there to work. They're not there to make money for their employer. They're just there for themselves. But I said, you got to show them initiative, because if you want to rise up on that totem pole and get to the top, get where you want to go, then you got to show them you want something from them. I want to tell you today that God wants us to rise to the occasion, because He wants us to rise up that Jesus pole, because He wants us to be somebody. But we got to put initiative in what we're doing and show that we want something from Him and we need it. And you know what? We're willing to pay the price for it. People don't want to pay the price. We see today that people aren't here because they didn't want to get out of bed. They didn't want to get up and come. They just would rather just lay around and do nothing and just let the day waste and go by because they didn't want to come to church.
Amen.
Well, that's hard, isn't it?
Amen.
That's just the truth. That's the way it is.
Amen. That's hard. Amen.
All right, you're going to say, well, you're the pastor. You always come. Yeah, I do. Even when I'm sick, I'm still here.
Yeah.
I was sick for 2 or 3 weeks, but I was still here.
Yes, amen.
I tried preaching and I coughed and choked and coughed some more, and you're probably like, man, where's he even up there? All he does is cough. But you know what? I said, I don't care. I'm going to preach no matter what. I'm going to keep on going.
Yes,
I'm not going to turn around. I'm not going to stop. I'm going to not do what God tells me to do.
Yes, amen.
Amen?
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, amen.
Give God a hand clap of praise.
Yes, amen.
Thank you, Lord.
It's all about Jesus.
Yes, amen.
And we have gathered all the chief priests and scribes the people together. He demanded of them where Christ should be born. He wanted to know. He was wanting to know, and it wasn't for a good reason. He wanted to know. How many knows that? He wasn't there to go and take him gifts. He didn't want to know where he was so he could go and just, you know, bring him to the palace or whatever and just put him in good purple clothes to take care of Mary and Joseph. He didn't want that for that reason. He wanted to get a hold of that child. He wanted to put him to death. He wanted to kill him. He wanted to take his life because he was afraid of him and afraid of what was coming. See, people are always trying to kill Jesus. They're always wanting to kill the Christians. I just saw on Facebook a young lady, a young girl. She is a Christian. And it was over in Syria. They beheaded her because she was a Christian. She was laying in the street, and it's graphic. It was a video of them taking her head off. Did anybody see it? I tried to get Cheryl to look at it. I don't want to see it. I'm not looking at that. You can look at it. They cut her head off in the street and let her lay there without a head. Her head's over here. Her body's here. Because they hate Jesus. They hate anything that anybody has to do with Jesus or represents Jesus Christ. They hate you. Herod hated Jesus. Herod wanted to put him to death. For one thing, he feared him. He feared what the people would do and how they would react when he grew up. And he did become the King of Kings, Lord. He wanted to stop it right then. He wanted it to end right there. I'm going to tell you what. Over 2,000 years later, it hasn't stopped. It hasn't ended. And Jesus Christ is still alive today, just as much as he was then. Amen? Yes, he is.
Yes, Pastor.
The theme of the power of Christmas truth, the message today is the power of Christmas truth. And the power of Christmas truth is to tell you that Jesus Christ came as a baby in a manger, but yet he comes as the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the mighty I Am. He comes as one that will come back, and he will come to rapture a people. He will come to set everything right. God had a plan from the very foundation of earth of how that Jesus would come, that he would be born of the Virgin Mary, he would grow up, he'd be 33 and a half years old, he would have to go to the old rugged cross, he would die, he would become the Savior of the world, he would take away the sin of the world, he would make it easy for us to be saved, he would come to give us health, he would come to heal us. All those things were the plan of God, that he would come and do those things. That's the power of Christmas truth. That's the truth about Christmas. Everybody has taken today and they've made it into a commercialized Christmas. They've taken and made it to where we buy gifts and we're all giving gifts to each other and we're just buying to see who can outdo each other. They've lost the true meaning of Christmas, which is Christ. They've come and taken and they've made it Xmas. They've taken Jesus right out of Christmas and they've made it just a thing of the season, or they've made it a holiday, and that's what they call it today. They don't say Merry Christmas. Happy holiday. Because they don't want to offend anybody because you're saying Jesus Christ. You're talking about the Christ, the one that made Christmas. They don't want you to be offended because all the other people are offended if we say Christmas. So we're just going to take it and change it and say, everybody say Happy Holidays. I beg your pardon. I'm not going to say Happy Holidays. I'm going to say Merry Christmas. I don't care if they're offended. I don't care if they get mad. I don't care if they go away and pout. I never want to talk to that guy again. He offended because he said Christmas. We find out that they've taken everything and made it a day that we have to go out and spend all our hard-earned money and everything we have and go and buy all these presents because we're making everybody happy. I'm not sure that Jesus Christ came to make everybody happy without having to buy all the gifts because the gifts he gives come from the Father of Lights, and it says it's the greatest gift you could ever get.
Amen.
Those gifts come from heaven. Those gifts cannot be bought on this earth because he comes to give you joy, peace, love, long-suffering, kindness, gentleness, meekness. He comes to give you all the things, the gift of the Spirit that he knows you've got something. He comes to give you the love that you could only have for people because he gave you that love and he put it in your heart and he replaced it with the hatred you had for that person once.
Yeah.
You ever knew anybody you could not stand them?
Yeah.
You couldn't stand to be around them and you just, oh no, here they come, everybody run.
Right.
Oh, get away from him. You don't want to talk to this guy. He's so negative. I mean, everything he says is criticizing, and I don't want to hear him talk. I hate that guy. Mm-hmm. You go to church and get saved and get down on your knees and really get Jesus in your heart. You go back to work Monday morning, you see the guy coming and you say, hey, here you come, let's talk to him. Once you hated him and now you love him, I don't know why. I just do.
Yeah.
People ask, what? You hated him Friday. Now Monday, you love him? Yeah, I do. I don't know. Something changed over the weekend. I just feel different about it.
Right.
You know what happened? Jesus got a hold of your heart. He changed your heart.
Right.
He took the hatred out of your heart and he replaced it with the love that only you could love that person.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I find out that when I walk the walk and I talk the talk, that I come and people will listen because they know that you have something to say. When you act like you have the power and you deny the power thereof, and you come in and they know that there's, you know how many that knows that there's sheep and wolves clothing?
Oh yeah.
They will come in, they profess to all this holiness and righteousness and all the things. But you know what? You find out later that they didn't have no righteousness. They were in sheep's clothing. And once it was revealed, they were ravenous wolf. And you saw what they were, and you found out what they were, and you know, then it was revealed unto you. God is a revealer. He will bring the darkness to the light. He will bring what was in darkness, he'll bring it to the light. Amen? But Herod wanted to destroy all that. Let me get into the message. He wanted to destroy all that.
Yes.
He wanted to take Jesus out of the equation.
Yes.
When you take Jesus out of the equation, if you did, you would have no reason to be here today.
Yeah.
You could not have been saved because you could not. There was no hope for you to go to heaven.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jesus Christ made the way for you. Amen? Yeah. I find almost wishful thinking. Christmas has become so complex, so chaotic, so confusing with all the stuff that the reality of the simplicity of the birth of Christ has been blended into the fantasy and has lost its significance.
Yes.
See, what happened, we took something that was so easy, and people have taken and made it so complex that we can't get saved, or we have to live this life once we get saved is just impossible. Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you right now that it's so possible because Jesus Christ made it so easy that we may have salvation, because all we have to do is confess it with our mouth and believe in our heart that says you shall be saved.
Right.
Amen?
Yes, amen.
We got to know that God made it so easy. John 3:16. There's your answer.
Yeah.
For God so loved the world.
Yes, yes.
That he gave his only begotten Son.
Amen.
That whosoever believeth him shall not perish, but they shall have everlasting life. That comes from the Father to say about his Son.
Yes.
If you have his Son, you have everlasting life.
Yes, amen.
He made it so easy for us. It's so easy for anybody to come to Jesus Christ. It's so easy for them to get saved and stay saved under the grace of God, because, see, what happens, God comes and cleans you up. He comes, and as you come closer to God and come closer to Jesus, and you stay fervent in prayer, and you get yourself where you should be in reading your word and going to church, what happens is God continues to keep taking those things out of your life that shouldn't be there. And he keeps cleaning you up and taking away. And what he does is he takes those things out and he replaces with greater things in your life that brings you closer to Jesus. But he will take them away. You don't have to worry about giving it all up. You cannot clean a fish before you catch it. You ever see anybody clean a fish and before they caught it? No. You got to catch that fish and you got to bring it up on shore. And, you know, sometimes it'll flip and flop and get out of your hands and go back in the water. And it leaves. And you can't get that fish back unless you can catch it again. But you get the fish out of the water. And then once you get a hold of it and get it up on dry land, and then you can clean that fish. And that fish is clean. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus has to clean it. We have to catch it before we clean it. You can't go trying to clean everybody up and tell them how to live. And telling everybody, you know, you got to do this. You got to do that. You got to do this, but you can't do that. You can't do this. You can't do that. Well, what can I do? Nothing. You mean I can't do nothing? You can't do nothing. Why would they want to be a Christian? Why would they want to just, you know, give everything up in their life if you told them that? You got to tell them. You know what? Jesus loves you. He came to save you. And he wants to make your life better. The only way you're going to get better is if you let God take those things out of your life and let him clean you up. Amen? And we can preach it and teach it and do everything we can, but we can't make you do it. You know, that's just like you can lead a horse to water. You cannot make that horse drink. You don't have the power to make that head of that horse go down that water and drink. Unless you're Samson. You never got more power than a horse. They're strong. And their will is strong. You cannot make it drink if it doesn't want to. And that's the way people are. You cannot make them take Jesus and get cleaned up and eat it. They don't want to. They're not
going
to.
Amen.
It takes the ones that really want to do it. And they put their efforts into it. Amen. They follow that star.
That's right.
Christmas should be simple, not complex. Very simple. Christmas should be stripped of all of Satan's devices so that all that is left is the simplicity of God becoming man. That is the only element in the Christmas season celebration that has its everlasting power effect of life. There is no strength, no real peace or comfort or hope or love or promise or confidence for the future to be found in Santa Claus. How many knows that? There's no future in Santa Claus. There's no hope in Santa Claus. Yeah, we bring our children up and we tell them about Santa Claus and we tell them, oh, you know, you better watch out. You better not pout. You better not cry. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. See, we tell them. Santa Claus is coming to town, so you better be good because he's watching you. And he sees what you're doing, and if you're bad, he's not bringing nothing bad. If you're good, you're getting a lot of gifts. See, we take Santa Claus and try to replace Jesus Christ with Santa. We try to give these kids hope that there's a future, there's something there for them. I can give them Jesus Christ and teach them and tell them about the one that came to save them and to give them eternal life. And you know, what better gift could he give than eternal life? You think Santa Claus is going to come and give you eternal life? Is Santa Claus going to come and give you anything? If you even really believe in him, I know, wake up. Hello. Are you awake this morning? If you're awake, say, I'm awake.
I'm awake.
Santa Claus is not real. Sorry, you bust your bubble. Amen. Bust some bubbles this morning, Brother Dan. Santa Claus is not real. I mean, come on now. Jesus is real. He's the real thing. They always said Coke's the real thing. No, he's not. Jesus is the real thing. He's the one. He's the reason for this season, for every season. Amen?
Amen.
Matthew 1 and 2, four titles are given to Christ. I'm going to give you these four titles, and it tells, and we're going to see what it means and what each one of these means. Four titles given to Christ, each of which gives us insight into why he was so sufficient for us and the only real power in Christmas. First of all, in verse 21, he said he is called Jesus. Verse 23, he is called Emmanuel. Verse 24, he is called King. 25, he is called Christ. All of the titles for that one little child, Jesus, Emmanuel, King, and Christ. I don't know about you, but how many's got a nickname in here? How many's got nicknames? Nobody else got a nickname? Okay. All right, nicknames is what somebody probably put on you when you're a child or labeled you as you're growing up, and they put that name on you. Maybe you hate it or maybe you like it. I don't know. Everybody's always, because my name is actually Richard, but everybody called me Rick, which is short for Richard. And then everybody, my brother and some other people call me Ricky. So I don't know what, you know, you go, don't call me Ricky. I'm a grown man. I'm not a child anymore. Now, when I was a child, okay, call me Ricky. But now I want to be called Rick or Richard.
Richard.
You know what Richard means? I'm going to brag on myself. Lionhearted. That's what it means, lionhearted. I always like that because I'm Richard. And there was King Richard, and he was lionhearted. So anyway, but your nickname comes when people know you, your close friends know how to relate to you. And when they see you coming, they're going to call you by your nickname. And whether you like it or not, they've labeled you with that and they put it on you. And so old Saint Nick cannot be a nickname for Jesus Christ. Old Saint Nick cannot be what it takes to replace Jesus Christ. And we have taken and put him in our homes, and we put him on our Christmas trees. We put him pictures of him on our walls. We put him everywhere. We put him in the shopping malls. We put him in the stores. We put him on the streets. And we let the little children go and come up to him like he's really going to do something for them. I'll tell you what, Saint Nick can't do nothing for them, but my Jesus Christ can do everything for them. He can come to give them a Christmas that it'd be the best Christmas of life if they gave their heart to Jesus Christ, because that's the best Christmas that he could ever give them, the best present you would ever have. How many agree with that? That's the greatest present you would ever have. These titles will tell us how the child of Christmas has the power to restore a fainting heart. First of all, let's consider the name Jesus. In verse 21 it says, "And she will bear a son. You shall call his name Jesus. Why? Because it is he who will save his people from their sins." Jesus, he gives salvation to his people. Down in verse 25, it says, "When he was born," it says that Joseph called his name in obedience to God, and it says his name shall be Jesus. Luke 2:11 says he would be born a Savior. Mark 4:10-45 says the Son of Man has come to save. In Luke, the 19th chapter, the 10th verse, it says, "He has come to save also. He shall save his people from their sins." That is the glorious reality. The Apostle Paul, writing in Ephesians 1:7, says this, "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses." Now the implication here is that men are sinners. How many knows that? We are once sinners. We are saved by grace. And only by the grace of Jesus Christ have you been saved. No other way can you be saved. All men must come to Jesus Christ and give their hearts to him to become saved. They can only come through Jesus to get to the Father. How many knows that? Now the implication here is that men are sinners, and that sin is a reality from which man needs to be saved or delivered or rescued from their sins. And Jesus came into the world to save you from your sins. See, he came to do all the things he did. He opened blinded eyes. Yes. He raised the dead. Yes. He caused the lame to walk. Yes. He opened deaf ears. Yes. He took away leprosy. Yes. He did all the things. He delivered people from evil, demons, spirits. Yes. He cast out devils. He did all the mighty things that only Jesus could do, but yet that wasn't why he really came. He came for the main reason of saving the people from their sins, that they may make restitution with God, and that his blood would come to save them. He came to save them because he can make you better on this earth, and you might get better and be healed, but you're still going to die again. You will still have to be able to call upon the name of Jesus if you don't. And you know what? Before you die, you're going to go to the devil's hell because it says you will. I didn't say it was God's hell. God created it not for human beings. He created for Satan and his angels. But when sin came and Adam and Eve fell from the garden, God said, "Now you must pay for your sins." But then Jesus came in Matthew, and he came to make it better and easier for us that we may then become saved from our sins. I'm going to skip on through before we run out of time. I want to talk to you about Leviticus, the 16th chapter. At the Last Supper, as Jesus gathered with his disciples the night before he was to be taken prisoner and then crucified, he took the cup and he said regarding this cup, that this cup is representative of the blood of the new covenant, of his own blood. He said, which is poured out. And he said in Matthew 26 and 28, he says, it's for the forgiveness of sins. In Acts 13, 38 and 39, the scripture says this, through him, that is Jesus Christ, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and through him, everyone who believes is freed from all things. You see, he was a child born to provide forgiveness of sins. Israel's great holy day is called Yom Kippur. That's the day of atonement for the Jews, and they will, when this day comes, they will travel for days. They will prepare for this day, this one day of atonement that comes, and they will travel, and they don't matter how far they got to go, it don't matter how they have to get there, they will leave their jobs, they will leave their families, they will leave everything, they will do whatever they can to get to this day of atonement called Yom Kippur. And they will travel to get there because it's the day of atonement for them. That's when they take, and the priest takes, and he takes two goats. And he takes one of the goats, and what he does, he will kill that one goat. And he will take its blood, and he will put it upon the altar, and he will spread it all across the altar. He'll take that blood. And he takes it, and he puts it all over the altar, and he covers it with the blood of the goat. And it's for the washing away of the people's sins. And all the sins that they've committed throughout the year now is going to be taken away by God, and then they're going to have their sins forgiven. Boy, I tell you what, they are so fooled now because they're fooled by the New Testament coming. They won't believe it, yet they still want the Day of Atonement. They want to be able to go out and sin all they want and do all they want through the year and come for that one day. The one day only where they can come and they can get their sins forgiven, and they think that it's okay. No. But here it is. He takes the goat, he kills it, and spreads the blood all over the altar. The other goat, what he does is he goes over and he puts his hand on the goat. And he lays his hand on it. And he transfers all the sins of all the maybe millions of people who come for the Day of Atonement for Yom Kippur. He comes and he puts his hand on it. They're all watching. They're all in awe of what he's going to do right now. He's getting ready to take all their sin and pull all the sin away from them. And he's getting ready to put it on this goat. And when he lays his hand on the goat, it transfers their sin from them to the goat. Ah. Come on now. Come on. You ever heard anybody say, you know, you're the scapegoat? You know where they got that from? No. Scapegoat is from the goat, because he put the sins on the goat. What you did is on the goat, and that's your scapegoat. That's your excuse. That's people's excuses, and they always say, you always got a scapegoat, don't you? Everything you do, and if it doesn't turn out right for you, you got a scapegoat. You've always got reasons, excuses, and reasons why you didn't do it or why, you know, why it happened. That's your scapegoat. You put it on that scapegoat and it goes away and you never see it again. It's a scapegoat. He takes the goat, what he does is he lays hands on it and he puts the sin into the goat. And then they take the goat out into the wilderness. And they will take that goat so far out that nobody will ever see that goat again. That it is out there, way out in the wilderness, and they travel back. And did you get it out where nobody else sitting in? Yes. All right. Your sins are forgiven. The goat has taken your sins, and the other goat, the blood has been applied to the altar, and therefore God has forgiven your sins. Now, go until Yom Kippur next year. Go back home and just live like you were. Live like you are. Do anything you want. And then next year, this day, on Day of Atonement, the day of Yom Kippur, come and we will do the same thing again and take away the sins of the people. What do you see wrong with that? I see this. Apostle Paul said this. He said, I died I got to go back to the cross every single day of my life. I got to refresh and renew myself in Jesus Christ because I sin. He realized that he had sin in his life and he had to keep asking Jesus Christ to come in his life and forgive him the things he did. As we're talking about an apostle that wrote 13 books of the New Testament. We're talking about an apostle that went to the third heaven. We're talking about an apostle that with Jesus Christ when he was blinded on the road to Damascus. And they took him, he was knocked off his animal, and therefore he was blinded, and God took him to third heaven and showed him all the things and showed him who Jesus Christ was. Jesus Christ, even that, he heard it in an audible voice of Jesus, said to him, Paul, Saul, why persecutest my church? Why do you persecute my church? Paul said, but I was doing this for God. I was doing it in my Jewish tradition because I am a Hebrew of Hebrews. I am from the stock of Abraham. I know the laws better than most people know the laws. I was brought up in the law. And Jesus, I thought I was doing you a great service, doing God a great service by taking the Christians and killing them. Jesus said, do it no more. For now, Paul, Saul, your name will be changed to Paul. And now you will be the Savior, the one that will go and save all the Gentiles. You will go to the Gentile nations and you will preach the gospel. You will preach Jesus Christ and win the lost. See, we always want that scapegoat, don't we? There will be no scapegoat in heaven when Jesus Christ comes and it says, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. It says, even the ones that pierced him will see him. The ones that pierce him will have to bow on their knees before him and say, you were the Lord of Lords. You were the King of the Jews. We crucified you. They will have to bow on their knees before him. Herod, all the ones that were present, and they said, give us Barabbas. Give us Barabbas. We want Barabbas. Take Jesus. Crucify Jesus. Let Barabbas go because we want him to pay for what he's done. He's blasphemed our God. Scapegoat. God's going to tell you when you come into his kingdom, we're not saved and we meet him that way, he's going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. And that's when they're going to pull out their scapegoat. They're going to reach in their pocket or whatever, and then pull that goat out. Look, this is my scapegoat, God. Here's all the reasons why I couldn't serve you. Here's all the reasons, the excuses why I didn't serve you. You know what God's going to say?
Depart from me.
That scapegoat ended in the New Testament. When I sent my son as a baby in a manger, when I sent him to die for your sins on the cross, that abolished the scapegoat because I made it so easy for you. That all you had to do is come and ask Jesus Christ, my son, to come into your life. And ask for the forgiveness of sins, and that's how easy it was for you to get saved. And all you had to do, and yes, you would have made mistakes along the way, but you know what? You're just like Apostle Paul, my apostle, you went to the cross every day and you died back out to my son, Jesus Christ. That's how easy it is. How many people have a scapegoat today? How many Christians have scapegoats? How many people had them this morning?
Everybody.
You see how many had one?
Everybody.
They had excuse after excuse. I mean,
everybody.
I've heard every excuse in the book. Why I can't come to church. I got a hangnail. This is no lie. I've got a hangnail on my big toe, and it hurts so bad I can't walk.
Amen.
Cut it out of there. What's wrong with you? Don't you have fingernail clippers, toenail clippers? Can't you cut your own toenail? Come on. How old are you? Get somebody, if you can't get down and cut it, get somebody to cut it out for you. I'd rather get that toenail cut out than get cut out of God's kingdom.
Amen.
God's going to take his giant toenail clippers and he's going to clip you out of his kingdom. He's going to clip you right out. Matter of fact, you know, he's going to take his little tools and get in there and he's going to clean out all that. Get it all cleaned out. I mean, that's pretty bad when somebody calls you and said, Pastor, I can't come to church this morning because I've got a hangnail. Oh, dear Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus. Scapegoat. scapegoat. I got a headache. Take a Tylenol. Well, come on, that's what they're for. Take something for a headache. Now, I just want to get to the nitty gritty. I'm going to close. The bottom line, I had a huge message, but I didn't preach much of it, but that's okay. The bottom line is this. We will not be able to make any excuses with God. We will not be able to say this or that. And there are legitimate reasons why you can't come to church. I know that. And I'm kind of making light of the things that, you know, people call me and tell me. But still yet, you know, there's reasons why people can't come. And I understand that. I do. I mean, there are good reasons. And if they can't, they can't. But I know that I want to try to stay faithful to my God. I couldn't. It's just not in me to just not go to church on a Sunday morning. If I didn't go here, I'd be going somewhere. Believe me. I would be in church. Somewhere else. And I wouldn't care if I could never get up in the pulpit and preach. They probably wouldn't let me. I don't care if I could get up there and sing. They wouldn't let me. I'd be lucky to get to testify maybe, but I would still be in church. Because I've got to have that because I've got to have Jesus Christ. Yes, I can pray at home. I can pray in my car. I can pray anywhere I'm at, and I read my Bible every day. There's not a day goes by that I'm not reading and studying and I'm not praying. I can do all that. But yet, I've got to be in an atmosphere where God says, come into my house. Forsake not to assemble yourselves together in my house, because there is meat in my house. I've got to be fed by the Word. And it's, you know, I say, well, you preach it every day, every Sunday. You know what? I like to hear other preachers too. I like to hear them because I glean from their word. I glean from theirs and I take what they've got in, and it's good. And it encourages me and makes me feel better in Jesus Christ. See? We need it. We got to have it. We stay out of church, and the longer we stay out, it's harder to come back. You ever want a child, when you were a child, if you missed a day of school, how hard was it to go back the next day? If you miss that next day, boy, it was even harder to go back to school. You miss 2 or 3 days, they almost had to tie you to a horse or something and drag you to get you to go to school. Because you don't want to go back. And that's the way it is with church. When we get out, you know, we can stay out the 1 week, it's okay. We get out the next week, then it's a little easier the next week, and then easier the next week. And pretty soon, you won't go back. You have to you got to tie a noose around your neck and pull you back in. So God wants us to be in His house. He wants us to enjoy each other's company and come together. And it's not all about disfellowship. It's come to feel the Spirit of God in you. It's come to feel God's Spirit and know that He is still alive today. He's not a baby in a manger. Yes, He came for us. But He is the Lord of Lords. He is the King of Kings. He is the mighty I Am, Sister Sherry. And He is sitting on the right hand of God. And He is getting ready to come and rapture His people. It is so close. We are at the very, very, very end of days before Jesus Christ comes back. I have seen all the prophecy that He told us about. I've seen it all fulfilled. Sister Mel, it's all fulfilled. Everything that Jesus told us, it's already happened. We are in the tribulation period. We're not beginning in it. We're not getting ready to go into it. We're in mid-trib. We're in the middle of the tribulation period. And we are getting ready to see some things happen because the gas prices are going down and the oil is going so low. The Russia is already feeling the big effects and they're starting to go into recession. And they said, America is next. We're getting ready to go into one of the biggest recessions we've ever seen. I hope it doesn't happen. Praise God and mercy God, but if it's God's will, then it has to happen. Amen? It will come to pass. But if that happens, we're going to see things happen that people are going to be hurting. How many has been to the store lately? How many have seen the prices just soaring? And every time you can go to today and look at the prices, and then you can go in a couple days and you go back up. What in the world? It's a dollar more. Everything is going up so fast, and we are going to see the rise more in food products and everything else because of the oil. And Arab countries, very, very wealthy, rich, billion billionaires. They are dropping and they're bottoming out the oil. Syria is one of them. And they're getting the oil down so low that it's going to affect all the other nations, non-Muslim nations. Because they have lots and lots of resources and money. it's going to affect all the other countries. And they did it once before when we had a great recession. They did it that time, and that's what happened. Now they're doing it again. They're playing games with that, so we'll go to recession. But yet, they don't even know that they're fulfilling prophecy. See, God works, and we say, oh my. But when you read the Word and you study and know what it says about the end days and what would take place and what's going to happen, you're going to go, oh yes. Because I know that Jesus Christ is coming back soon. And we better be ready, church. We've never been ready before. We better stay on our knees. We better stay in prayer. We better stay ready. Because I don't know about you, but I don't want to be left behind. You get left behind, once that's done and Jesus Christ comes and raptures His church, then it's going to hit the fan. There's going to be such chaos as this world's never seen it. There will be things happen that you've never seen. The Bible says so. There will be things that come up on the earth that no man's ever seen before. God starts pouring out the vials of the plagues. He starts putting them into effect. The martial law is going to come into effect. Just what we just seen in Ferguson, Missouri, how they had to bring the troops in and all that stuff because of rioting and everything. Believe me, when Jesus Christ comes back and all the people are raptured, the millions of people are going to be gone. The people that were store owners, that were wealthy, that had houses, they're no longer there. Guess what people's going to do? They're going to be rioting, looting. They're going to be breaking in, taking everything they got. It's going to be total chaos. They will make you take the mark. The government will come and say, now you, because people are missing, we don't know where they're at, we can't find them. Now if you take the mark, we'll be able to find you. It will have a tracking device, and then we're going to put all your banking and all your medical records, everything will be on that. And now we don't have to worry about it anymore.
How do you know about that?
The beach.
They got the bike now. You start to call up and do everything.
Oh, yes.
Where are you going?
They know because of technology, because of technology and the computer systems and all the technology they have. You will go in the store. And at that time, you will walk in and you'll go through the store and you'll shop. You'll come up with your grocery cart. You'll put stuff on the belt like you always do, okay? And it'll go down and they'll say, oh, wait a minute, I got to scan you. Bible says it's going to put a mark on your forehead or the back of your hand. It's going to be right here. They got a bead chip that they will insert as small as a lead on a pencil. They insert that in there, it has everything about you. And if you take that mark, that's the mark. 666. No, it said the Bible says know the number 666. Take that mark. You are doomed forever. You will not make it into heaven. But there's going to be a great travesty by not taking it because when you put your food up there, then the person at the register is going to say, I got to scan you. They will take their scanner just like they do and they'll say, wait a minute. Is it in your other hand? No, you can't buy nothing. You don't have the chip. You can't have this food. But I have money. That money is no good. You can't buy nothing. You won't be able to sell nothing legally. You won't be able to work a job because the job's going to be putting all your money on this in your banking system. You're not going to be able to do nothing. You will be an outlaw. You will be an enemy of the state. You will be on the run. They will hunt you down. All these things are going to come. Church, believe me. This is not a fairy tale. This is not a fantasy. This is just not something somebody made up. It's going to happen. We need to be ready now that when Jesus Christ comes, and it says that He's going to come like a thief in the night. He's going to be come and go. Nobody will even know how. It's going to be within the twinkling of an eye, and He'll come and go. It says two will be sleeping in the bed, one will be taken, one will be left. Two will be grinded at the mill, one will be taken, one will be left. There'll be two in the field. One be taken, one be left. I'm just telling you that the ones that are ready will go. The ones that are not, we have sin in our life and have not repented of it, we will not make it. Amen? I'm going to close with that. And I just want to let you know that Jesus Christ is the reason for the season. And don't ever stop saying Merry Christmas. I don't care how many people get offended. I don't care how many people get offended. I'm going to say Merry Christmas. And they can say Happy Holiday all they want, but say Merry Christmas. Look at your neighbor and say Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. All right, it's all about Jesus, isn't it? Let's all stand to our feet and close it. Continue praying for Sister Linda. She needs our prayers. She's really hurting. And all the other people, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to pray this afternoon, and I want you to really get down to business with God and pray about the concert tonight. I want you to pray that God pours out His Spirit upon this church tonight. There will be people coming through these doors that are not saved. This might be the opportunity that God needs to save them. But we've got to be in an attitude of worship and praise tonight. We've got to set the tone. We've got to set the Spirit for them to be able to come and feel that power, feel that convicting power, come to these altars and run and get saved. If you see somebody tonight, I want you to help me do this. If they're at their pew and you see them praying or maybe crying and tears are coming down, I need you to go and just, you know, very gently just go over and put your hand out and ask them, "Can I pray with you?" You could help lead them to Jesus Christ. They might not get up and come, but if you see that, we need to go back and just put your hand on them and say, "Can I pray with you? Could I help you to pray and get Jesus in your life?" We need to do that. Amen? They're hurting. And people don't know which way to turn. They don't know what to do. But we do, don't we? And if anybody can't be here tonight, if you want to give a donation to help the needy families we're going to be helping, I want you to do that. Sister Cheryl will have a basket back here. Is it back there?
Yep.
If you want to, you can. If you can't, I understand. That's okay. You don't have to. But anyway, and please tell everybody you know to come tonight. We're going to have food in the back, and all the money in the proceeds, you already know, we're taking that, and that's going to help families. And they need help. So, amen?